I have fallen victim to Centrelink's Robo-Debt program. Well, technically not me, but my wife was sent a letter recently saying that she owes Centrelink, the Australian government's social security program, over $7,300. That's not a nice letter for anybody to receive. Yes, due to my wife having a young child, and due to my income being under a certain amount, my wife had been entitled to a fortnightly payment over the last 3.5 years, that is, since the birth of our daughter. Actually, we didn't even know about the payment. It was the midwives down at the hospital that told us about it and gave us a form to fill out. They said it wouldn't hurt to fill out, so we did. So over the last 3 or so years, my wife has had to report our income every fortnight in order for Centrelink to calculate the correct payment amount. Some fortnights, she doesn't receive anything because my income is too high. Other fortnights, she only receives $50 or $100. The maximum she can receive in any given fortnight is a touch over $500. That usually happens during my semester breaks, when I'm not working. So anyway, fast forward 3 years, and it turns out that she owes the government $7,300 due to overpayment. I was a bit peeved, because we had done everything that the government had asked. How could she possibly be $7,000 in debt? Naturally, we went down to the local Centrelink office to try to sort everything out. We were there for about half a day. As anybody who has dealt with Centrelink would know, things aren't done quickly. They are notoriously understaffed. Finally, when my wife was called up, she wasn't even in the building, because she had to step out to take the children to the toilet. The nearest toilet was at the local bus station, a few minutes' walk away. As we found out, Centrelink don't actually have any public toilets. So I raced up to the staff member and explained that my wife had to take the children to the toilet. She was okay about it and said I could speak to her in the meantime. After telling her our situation, and after she tapped away on the computer for about 5 minutes or so, she came to the conclusion that Centrelink couldn't help us. I was like, "What? We've been waiting here for hours. How can this be?" She was very apologetic and told us that nobody in the local office had any dealings with the debt collection department, or words to that effect. There was not a single person in the building that could help us. My wife came back, and the staff member repeated the information to her. She advised us that we should ring the debt department for free via the phones in the waiting area. We begrudgingly complied. I jumped on the phone and sat there for an hour or so listening to elevator music. My wife had to look after the children as they were getting hungry and restless. I was getting more and more peeved as time went by. I thought to myself, how can they make us wait for so long? How can it take so long before we can even talk to somebody about this issue? I started to feel really sorry for all those country people out there that I've seen on the news that spend all their days dealing with Centrelink. You see, a lot of them don't have a local Centrelink office and must ring them on their mobile phones. I've seen stories of people having to use all of their phone credits, or people whose phones have run out of power mid-conversation. Dealing with Centrelink is often like a full-time job for these people. They're supposed to be out looking for work, but instead they spend their days on the phone to Centrelink, trying to sort out one issue after another. Anyway, back to my story. While I was at Centrelink and waiting for them to answer the phone, I had to move the car a couple of times so I wouldn't get a parking ticket. Finally, somebody picked up at the other end, and I explained our issue to them. After a few minutes of tapping away on their keyboard, they finally admitted that they couldn't help and that they'd have to transfer me through to another department. I was like, "What? I've been in Centrelink all afternoon just waiting. I've had to move the car. I've had to deal with restless children. How much longer will I have to wait?" "Sorry, sir, but this is a specialized issue and has been assigned to a specialized department. Please hold." Again, I begrudgingly complied. What else could I do? It was either pay the $7,300, something that was clearly a mistake, or keep holding, hoping that eventually this nightmare would be over. Finally, actually only after a couple of more minutes of waiting, we got through to the debt calculation and recovery department. They informed me that they needed to speak to my wife first to confirm that I could speak to Centrelink on her behalf. You see, this debt was all based on my earnings, so really had nothing to do with my wife. I explained our situation to them again, and they explained to me how they calculated the debt. It turns out that I had apparently worked for 7 companies over the last 3 years, which simply wasn't true. I used to work 2 jobs up until a couple of years ago, one as a private maths tutor and one at the local university. It turns out that Centrelink had 3 different names for the same tutoring company. Just say the name of the business was Bill's Home Tutoring. They had it listed as Bill's Home Tutoring, William Smith, and William J. Smith, they had logged the business under three names, the actual business name and as two versions of the business owner's name. I explained this to them, but they said that it shouldn't matter as Centrelink deals with ABNs, Australian business numbers. It doesn't matter what the business name is, as long as the ABNs match, all relevant income data should be grouped. Anyway, I asked for her to read out some of the debt calculations. She said that in February 2016, we reported a fortnightly income of $652, but Centrelink calculated an income of over $1,500. That single entry resulted in a debt of $429. I was like, how can that be? How could our reported income be so different to the actual income? Either we were lying, or Centrelink has made a mistake. Of course, she didn't want to admit that Centrelink had made a mistake, and continued to read out numbers to me. She said that Centrelink matched data from the Australian Taxation Office, so it's unlikely that there would be a mistake. I thought to myself, yeah, right, Centrelink have only been splashed all over the news talking about all the issues with their so-called robo-debt program. Robo-debt, you see, is an automated system that matches data from the Australian Taxation Office, as well as from other sources, and automatically sends out debt recovery letters to people. It's caused real heartache to many thousands of Australians. It's a hard thing to fight, as I have found out, and it's terrible that the Australian government have allowed this to happen. They are inadvertently targeting Australia's most vulnerable citizens. People who simply don't have the money are being told that they are thousands of dollars in debt. It is well known that one-third of large Australian companies paid no tax last year. See the link below for the details. Instead of the government closing all the loopholes that allow these huge companies to avoid tax, they instead target Australia's most vulnerable, who they know can't fight back. But unfortunately for the Australian government, I'm not going to lay down. They've picked the wrong person to start a fight with. Not that they'd care, of course. Whether they get the $7,000 or don't get the $7,000, it won't hurt them in the slightest. This battle can only have one loser, and it's not the government. The lady on the Centrelink phone advised that there was nothing that she could do, but she could elevate the issue and make a request for an official review of the debt. I agreed, and she went through with the initial stages of the process. She said that if we like, she could send through the debt calculations, officially a document titled ADEX Debt Schedule Report, via snail mail. I asked if she could email it to us or send it via secure mail, but she insisted that she wasn't allowed to. She had to send it via the post. I told her that the debt due date was fast approaching and that we wouldn't have much time to review the debt calculations, but she told us that the debt due date is just the date that we have to start paying back the debt. We could still fight the issue during that time. So anyway, a week later, we finally received the debt schedule. As expected, there's mistakes everywhere. There's 3.5 years of data, so I simply don't have the time to find all the mistakes. Calculating the actual debt is not an easy process, so I only did it for 3 entries. It turns out that they had duplicated my income for the home tutoring job, probably due to the various names they had on file for the same company. I sent through my findings and told them that surely that's enough evidence for them to do a complete review of my wife's debt. They said they will get back to me in 10 business days. Time will tell. So yes, Centrelink's robo-debt is a complete failure. It doesn't do what the government intended, unless the government's intention was to scare ordinary Australians into submission. Luckily, I've got a maths background, because I'm sure that normal Centrelink recipients would just accept their fate and pay back the debt, even though there's a good chance that a lot of it is fake. To be fair, I do appreciate what Centrelink do. I'm appreciative that they have given my wife some payments over the last 3 years, even if they are claiming that she was overpaid. Every civil society needs social security. It wouldn't be fair to let people starve on the streets because they were down on their luck. However, if you're going to give people benefits, you have to make sure that you give them the correct amount. Overpayments should never happen. I would understand it if we were intentionally deceiving Centrelink, but that's not what's happening. My wife was doing everything in her power to be honest with Centrelink. She complied with everything they requested and went online and did everything they asked of her. It was a pain to do, too. But yet, 3 years later, they've hit her with a huge debt. It just doesn't seem fair. Personally, I've only ever received Centrelink payments once before in my life. Back when I was in uni, I received a benefit called Youth Allowance. Due to my circumstances at the time, they paid me a whopping $23 a fortnight. Yeah, I was raking it in. But then a couple of years later, they sent me a letter saying that I was overpaid. How much, you ask? The entire amount. I had to pay back over $800 of payments. Luckily, I had the money at the time, so just paid it in full. So technically, I haven't received a cent from Centrelink. To finish up, there's obviously issues at Centrelink. I'm not exactly sure what they are, but from what I've experienced in the last week or so, there's certainly communication issues. One department don't seem to know what the other departments are doing. Different workers give different advice. The income reporting process is flawed, as it allows for all these mistakes to occur. Robo-debt is a sham and is hurting many normal Aussies. Centrelink has become a place where the government punish the poor. Its culture needs improvement. Its processes need improvement. They've got to end this stupid robo-debt program and start treating recipients for what they are – people who need a helping hand. Centrelink recipients are often labelled dole bludgers. They are seen as people who just sit at home doing nothing and collecting paychecks. I'm sure there are some people who fit into that category, but from many of the people I've seen, most are hardworking and are just trying to live their lives in the best way they can. I was working two jobs, and my wife was still receiving some payments. It's all based on one's family income. I suggest that there are many normal Aussies who receive some sort of payment. What are your thoughts on Centrelink? Have you ever had any dealings with them? Are all Centrelink recipients just dole bludgers? Should the government remain tough on recipients so that they know that this isn't a free ride? Let me know below.